Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming out here today. It's very exciting to have our guest with us, and I'm glad you're all here. Is there anybody in the audience who's actually met through Twitter? Like, you met each other through Twitter? Anybody here? I see one hand. That's right. I met Michael through Twitter, and I met the Finks through Twitter. So it's a very unique opportunity we have in this business right now. Is, you know, when you watch television, you watch the news, this new social media stuff, you always hear people like, I don't really understand this new social media stuff. Well, that's what we're here to do today. And I'm sure almost everyone in the room is using social media in some way to communicate with friends, to keep up with family. But are you really using it in the best way to promote yourself as an artist? Are you using it in the best way to promote your career? And that's sort of the impetus behind today's event. And I met these lovely women who'll be presenting to you today through Twitter. This is only the third time we've been in the same room together in person. I used to teach in New York, and before I came here, I met a woman named Jeannie Bowerman, who was on Twitter, and she works for Script Magazine. And I started tweeting her about some things and told her I was going to Chicago. And then she said, you know, she tweeted me to the Finks and said, you gotta meet these people because they live in Chicago. And so that's sort of how this all came about. And what do they do, and why are they here today? Well, I wanted to bring them to you because they do a little bit of everything. They're these masterful media shapeshifters. They have produced, written and directed feature films. They have released documentary films. They have created three popular and money-making web series. They work for Tello Films, which is a profitable niche web series site. And they do media marketing. Actually, Julie just wrote an article for PBS Media, which got a ton of traction. They have 6,303 Twitter followers as of this moment, and have raised over $300,000 for their projects and for their clients. So they've figured out a way to do what they love to do and to get other people involved, which is what Twitter is all about. And if you're interested in running a Kickstarter, having these sort of social media connections is the first thing you have to do. So I'm going to let them talk to you about that. Please welcome Jess and Julie from King is a Fink.
That was a lovely introduction. And we're going to take it a little further and talk a little bit more about, you know, who we are and who we've been told you are and what you can expect from today. So again, I am Jessica, and this is Julie. Our own production company is King is a Fink Productions, and we've been making films for about 10 years. The first 5 years, we just made them for our friends, just to entertain them, and we learned that that is a lot of work to make your friends like you. At some point, we realized, you know, we're spending a lot of time doing this thing, and we really love it, so let's try to do it for real.
And we've invested a lot of money in this equipment.
Yes.
That we're making movies that we can't show anybody, so let's make them for real.
Yes. And so as soon as we started doing it for real, we had to, at the same time, start exploring social media. And Twitter had just kind of started taking off, and so we will say our talk today will be fairly Twitter-centric. We love Twitter. It is an incredibly powerful social media platform. And so we started on Twitter and Facebook, and then we graduated. And we now have used pretty much every social media platform that exists. And we'll tell you, you know, about which ones to use, which ones not to use, depending on what kind of artist you're trying to be. And so that started our journey, where, as Brad mentioned, we've made a couple of feature films, we've made a ton of shorts, and we now currently focus on making digital web content because it is what is paying for our life. And so I think what's nice about that is to know that this can happen. Like, I think a lot of people dream of being filmmakers, and they dream of going to Sundance, and they dream of, you know, being a big Hollywood screenwriter. And that may happen for many of you, but there are other paths to be able to do the kind of art that you want to do. Do you want to
add
anything?
And then also, out of learning how to do social media and out of learning how to do crowdfunding campaigns and telling everyone that we had learned how to do these things, we started getting asked for a lot of advice. We gave out a ton of free advice at first, and then we said, this is taking up a lot of our time. So we decided to do something that we were not very good at and started to monetize it. And so now we actually consult on other people's crowdfunding campaigns, and I do quite a bit of social media management for other people. And so I work for PBS, and I work for politicians and celebrities and other people who just need a little bit of help. And so that also gives us another revenue stream, so they don't have to have like a regular day desk job.
Which is horrible. Avoid
that if you get the chance. And then also lets me have a flexible schedule so we can actually make things.
Absolutely. So. All right, so that's a little bit about who we are. Today's talk, just so you kind of know the arc of it, we are going to spend a lot of time talking about social media. We are also going to talk about crowdfunding. That is going to be more towards the end. And the reason we have done it this way is that if you do not have a solid social media presence, there's no point in hearing us talk about crowdfunding. And so just understand that if you're listening and it's like, but when are they going to get to the money part? Well, you have to listen to all the first stuff. And you have to do all the stuff we say first before you can get to the second part, which is the money part. The other thing before we get started is there's something that might be a little uncomfortable that we have to talk about first. There's what I call, you know, the elephant in the room. And even though the elephant on the screen is awfully cute, that doesn't mean she's not dangerous. So what we have found in working with other artists, and also even just our own attitudes about how we've wanted to spend our lives, is a lot of artists, they don't want to do social media and they don't want to do crowdfunding because they have this misguided notion that they're just an artist and they want to create and that's all they want to do, and they don't want to be business people and they don't want to do marketing and they don't want to do all of these things that are actually really kind of horrible. We understand. Like, who wants to do their taxes? Who wants to form an LLC?
Not me. But we did it because you have to. You have to do things like get insurance to protect the people on your sets, to protect yourself against getting sued. Yeah, you have to do taxes. That sucks. Starting companies and dealing with those, that's horrible.
You have to think about things like, how do I want to promote and market myself? Yeah. Like, it again, for some people, you know, you're going to find, you know, someone to do that for you if, you know, you make it up into the upper echelons of, you know, Hollywood or whatever. But if, you know, on the way there or while you're waiting, you have to figure out how to do it yourself. And so the faster, if you have this idea in your head but I just want to create, the faster you can get that idea out of your head and be practical, the better. So we wanted to get that out of the way. There are, of course, a few exceptions. If, for example, you're a trust fund baby, and you can fund your own life, I don't know why you're here.
You should leave. You don't have to be here.
Yeah, and so if that...
Good for you. Call us later.
Maybe you'd like to invest.
Right.
So if you have that kind of situation, then you really don't need any of this unless you just want to have fun online. And we can teach you how to do that, too. Yeah. Or if your parents are wealthy, and also, in addition to being wealthy, also want to fund your life...
You can go have dinner. Go get a drink. You don't have to be here.
Yeah,
however, if your parents are wealthy and they don't want to fund your life because you just said, I want to make movies or I want to make art, and they want you to be a doctor, then you should stay.
Absolutely. And then finally, if you're planning to marry someone, or you already are in the, you know, process of marrying someone who's going to fund your life.
That's great. You don't have to be here.
Our mothers told us to do that.
And we didn't listen.
We totally ignored them.
It was dumb.
Yeah. So anyway. If you're still sitting in this room, we're assuming that you need...
And we'll help you out.
You think we can help you out.
Okay.
All right. So let's talk about the practicality. So what can social media do for you? It can do a lot of things, but we're going to focus on two of the most powerful things that social media can do for you. One, it can help you connect with fans and audience members for your work. And, you know, think about how many people are online who... they don't have a passion. I don't mean to like diss people, but a lot of people, they don't have a passion. They're looking to be entertained or they're looking to be enlightened, and they're not doing that for themselves. And so they are out on these platforms looking for people to give them something to think about or give them something to laugh about.
It's a time filler. It's entertainment. Some people,
yes,
you go on Twitter to look at the funny things or find news. Same with Facebook. You want to go find, you know, recipes and like what your friend's baby's medicine is. You go to Facebook so you can look at all that and be entertained after you get home from work.
Absolutely.
So, but you can also use it for business.
Absolutely. So there's audience, it's connecting with directly with audience members. And then the second thing is it can connect you with both collaborators and influencers. So for instance, when Brad introduced us today, he talked about like he met us through Twitter. And pretty much everyone we've worked with in film has been someone we met through social media. And this started back in 2010?
I think we got on in 2009.
Okay.
At the end of 2009.
Do you want to tell that story?
Sure. So we got on Twitter at the end of 2009. That's not the whole story. So we got on, we started meeting people. We didn't know what we were doing at all. And so we kind of started following people, and I started tweeting, and I was super rigid about it. I was like, we make movies. Here's a shirt I made. It was horrible. It was horrible. Then we loosened up, and we met some people. So we met this guy, a filmmaker up in Minnesota, and he said, hey, I'm a director, and I want to make a movie, but I don't want to write it. Do you want to write it? And that was exactly what we were looking for. We were writers. So yeah. We were like, yes.
Well, and plus, we had submitted one of our short films to a festival in his town
that we found out about through
Twitter. He saw one of our shorts and he's like, you people are totally demented. Please write my movie.
Yeah. We're like, sure.
Yeah.
Do it for free. Great. That's what you do in the beginning. So we made it for him and we crowdfunded for that movie. And then one of the people who backed the crowdfunding campaign saw that we were lesbians. Mm-hmm. I don't know how. We didn't ever say that. We have to tell you guys something. No. So figured out this thing about us that said, hey, they might be interested in this thing. And she said, you're a lesbian, you live in Chicago. I know a woman who makes web series for lesbians in Chicago. You should meet her. And we were like, no way. We don't like to leave our house. We like to do Twitter. But then we met with her anyway because it seemed like a good business plan. And so that is, we met with Kristen, who owns Tello, and that's what we work for now. That actually brings in a really significant portion of our
income.
Mm-hmm. So yay, Twitter. And that happened in 2000. We met the guy in 2009. After submitting one of our silly shorts, it led to a feature that led to us meeting this woman in the rest of our lives. And it really led us to here. I feel like everything's just led to this moment with you guys. I'm pretty much done. Okay.
So the point is that you really can, it is a very, not just Twitter, but all of these social media platforms can be incredibly powerful networking tools if you know how to use them well. And so that's what we're going to get into today. So, now let's talk quickly about what social media cannot do for you. Julie, what can it not do for you?
It will not make your movies for you. It will not make good movies for you. It will not make your stuff. So you cannot get on Twitter and get obsessed with Twitter like someone might have done when she first got on Twitter and never write anything and never make anything.
Might have happened.
I might have done that for 3 months. I might have been on Twitter like crazy. I loved it. I was addicted to it. But I wasn't writing anything, which meant we couldn't make anything. Mm-hmm. We write together.
Yeah.
But
there might have been some fights about it.
I don't remember.
We're not going to go into them.
I'm just saying, the thing that you want to be doing, that you want to use Twitter to promote, you still have to be doing that other thing. So you still have to be planning your next shoot. You still have to be editing your next thing that you're going to share. Because for us, as creators who have to promote our own work, you have to have something to promote.
Yes.
So there has to be a balance.
And we see a lot of people on social media who do end up just being obsessed with social media, and they really do. It's like they've made one thing, and then they never make anything again, but they just stay there, and they keep talking.
It's fine if you don't make anything else.
Sure.
Making a movie is hard. No one should do it. But if you want to make a movie and you like it and you want to do it again, you have to pull your, you know, you have to unplug.
You do.
Jessica actually used to put me in Twitter jail. Mm-hmm. So I would get writing done. It's possible she sent me to my parents one time for a month to write because they didn't have Wi-Fi. That's not confirmed. That's just a story.
All right. The other thing that social media cannot do for you is it cannot make you instantly famous.
No.
And I think so. I mean, especially through Tello, we talk to so many young you know, very excited actors and filmmakers and creators, and they just, like, they have an idea for a show, and they're just like, we can't put it on Tello, it's behind a paywall, I'm gonna put it on YouTube, and I'm gonna get 3 million views.
Which is awesome.
Which is great, but they're not, and they don't, because no one knows who they are, because they don't have a social media presence. And, you know, unless you're Justin Bieber or Paris Hilton or any range of people whose names we all know, like, you're not going to become instantly anything. Like, the people who get things on social media who are not already celebrities are people who really, they work it. And they work these mediums and they work these platforms. And I think there's an illusion that people have and a hope, of course. Like, we all want, wouldn't it be nice if everything was easy?
Well, we're hopeful. Yes. We're filmmakers.
We're dreamers.
Like, stories. Yeah.
So you can't go into any of this thinking anything is going to be instantaneous. It is, you know, this has been a long road.
Yeah.
It is.
And I don't believe in viral. I know things go viral, but, like, nothing I ever do is ever going to go viral except for this show right now. It's
going to be boom. I mean, maybe if you have, like, a really fat cat.
If you have a Japanese cat.
Right, that likes to slide across the floor into
boxes,
a box.
You're set.
Then you're good.
You should go.
Right.
However, if you don't have that, you're probably not going to make anything that's going to go viral. Focusing on making something that's going to go viral is a waste of your time.
Absolutely.
Don't look up any articles about how to do that. Don't try to do that. It's silly. Make your stuff vibrant. We're going to talk about this more later, but make it the coolest thing that anyone's going to see that day. And it may not go viral and end up on The Soup, but you might get all of your friends on Facebook to share it with all of their friends and go, like, you know, mini viral or Chicago viral. I don't know. Like, just you got to focus on what's actually doable.
Yes. And you just have to focus on making work that's good.
Yeah.
All right. So where do you start? So if hopefully we've convinced you need to do this. But where do you start? There are so many social media platforms. I mean, it is just this, you know, Silicon Valley is just overflowing with very excited little people who are, you know, chasing venture capital. I don't know if they're little.
They're normal-sized,
very excited people.
Nice people.
Who are chasing venture capital, and they're trying to make the next, you know, Snapchat, Vine, you name it. And so then there's all these platforms, and which ones do you use? So we recommend start with 1 to 2, because it, again, I think this has been clear in how we've been talking so far. It's work. Like, it's part of your daily work. I mean, how many hours would you say you spend a day?
20. Well, I do, I spend easily 6 hours a day between my clients and then our work.
Right, but that's with clients. But with our own work, I mean,
still
1 to 2 hours
a
day.
Yeah.
You're, you know, thinking about how are you promoting yourself. And so you cannot do all the platforms. It's not possible. So pick 1 to 2. One, think about complementing your medium of expression. So for the most part, I think people are in TV and film, but some of you might be writers or if there's
photographers,
painters,
painting,
whatever.
Dancers.
There's different platforms that suit different types of art, for one. And then also, it should be something that you like. Like, if it doesn't suit your fancy, if it's not fun, don't do it. Like, if you, you know, hate writing long form work, do not start a blog. We learned that lesson the hard way.
That was horrible.
It's horrible. We like fast. We want to do Twitter. Short, quippy, clever, fast. It's over. We like it.
Right.
And we're going to talk about some of the different mediums in just a minute, but do things that actually fit your personality and fit your style. So, generally speaking, for any kind of visual artists, you want to be on Instagram. Instagram is actually really powerful. Pinterest, if you like to organize things that are visual. So Instagram is more just individual photos. Pinterest, you can just
create collections
of things. It's really good. I actually really like Pinterest. I don't do it as a way to engage fans. I make lookbooks for projects that we're working on so that I can share it with actors and things like that. And then if you have moving images, there's YouTube and there's Vimeo. Vimeo is more for people who care about the way it looks like it's just a prettier platform, and people get really super geeked out about camera equipment and lenses and, oh my God, what camera is that? Things like that. And so if you have more of that bent, Vimeo might be a better place for you to network and find people. Whereas YouTube is, there's the cat video competition. So, I mean, what are you going to do?
You're never going to win for cat videos. So just put that out of your mind.
Yeah, we frequently have a crisis, like once a month.
Not both of us.
Okay,
one of us.
I've maybe once a month break down and I'm like, we're trying too hard. Why? What?
Let's just get a cat.
Let's just get a cat.
Let's get a Vine account and a cat and we're done.
Right. So, and if you're more of a writer type, so if there's screenwriters in the room and you don't make video content, definitely if you're a writer, you absolutely should be on Twitter. There's no excuse. You can also do a Tumblr if you want to do something a little more bloggy, but not super long form bloggy, or if you want to blog with pictures, Tumblr's great. And also Tumblr, there's a lot of young people on Tumblr, although that's starting to change because when Yahoo bought it, they took all the porn off. People didn't like that.
We're not allowed to say porn. Well, this is college.
People didn't like that, so they're moving elsewhere. And then you can always do a blog on WordPress or Blogger. Blogger has a bit more of a community-based platform for sharing than WordPress does. But again, if you're going to blog, you really, truly have to be dedicated to doing it daily.
Yeah.
Because otherwise...
Or like twice a week.
Maybe twice a week. You get lost.
You have to do it. You have to do it regularly. We had a blog at first, and then we didn't keep up with it. And if you have a blog and then you abandon it, it's kind of embarrassing.
Right.
So, or it was for me. And so, because then, you know, someone looks you up, you're like, hey, here's my card. I have a blog. And then like, wow, last time you did it was October 2012. Like, you're really on it. So, yeah, so keep it up. We got rid of it. Use the content a different way. You know what we don't have on there is Facebook.
Oh. Facebook's fine.
It's on its way out. Yeah. No, I'm kidding. I don't know. Facebook's fine. We don't, obviously, we love Twitter. Facebook's fine.
Facebook's fine. Yeah. We're not going to say anything else about Facebook.
Facebook's all right. For your friends and your family, people. Come on. Okay.
All right. So you're on. What do you do? You get your Twitter account, and you're like, okay, I'm here. What do I do now?
I'm here. We're
I'm here. On. Where is everybody? So the first thing you need to do is you need to find, and this is true of whatever platform you get on, so it can be Twitter, Instagram, whatever. You need to find people to interact with because they are social platforms. So you need to go and look for other people who do what you do. That's the first thing, because you're not going to automatically find your fans, because, again, you've just arrived.
Because also, I feel like we should have said this earlier, no one's looking for you. And I don't mean that in, like, a soul-crushing, self-esteem-ruining kind of way. I just mean... Like, they don't know you're there yet. They don't know all the amazing things you're about to do.
Right.
Or, and so you have to let them know that you're there. Like, Cisse, where's Cisse? There you are. We love you. No one's looking for you. Yet. Yet. So you got to get on there. You have to start announcing a little bit.
Yeah.
You got to find people, let them know you're there, and then people start looking for you.
Yeah.
They are looking for you.
All right, so you find other people, and it can, and also I say be really diverse in terms of your interests too. Like, sure, if you're a filmmaker, follow other filmmakers. That's smart. But also, like, if you're interested in like documentary issues, and so then you might want to follow social issue people, or you know, NPR or whatever. You want to kind of broaden the range of things that you're interested in because it's going to give you more. To comment, engage, and compliment. Because the next thing, so now you're following people, they're saying things, they're posting pictures or whatever they're doing, and now you have to start talking about what you're seeing in this environment. And we'll talk a little bit more, like we use the word compliment here, we'll talk a little bit more about being positive and all of that later. But yeah, you want to engage with people. You want to ask them questions. You want to say, hey, I saw your video, or hey, I saw that article you posted. Wow, it really made me think about blah.
Or hey, I really hated it.
Sure.
That's a great conversation starter.
If you want to be that person, go right ahead. But, you know, stand behind it.
Be yourself.
Be yourself. And then also, this process is very time consuming. I mean... It took us a very long time to get the kind of following that we have now, and it's because we you know, we genuinely interact with people, and that's how people, they learn about your work, they learn to trust you, they learn your personality. This all takes a lot of time.
Yeah. Well, and you also can buy followers and fans.
Oh,
do you guys
do
know
that.
This? It's horrible. You can. You can suddenly have 1,000 followers. There's some site called, I think, Fiverr, mm-hmm. which is fine. And if they want to give us money, endorse it, we'll totally change our tune on this. But all I'm saying is you can do things and like buy 10,000 fans, or you can, mm-hmm. you know, buy 100,000 views on YouTube. Well, so if you have 100,000 Twitter followers, that looks awesome if I don't know you. I'm like, oh, wow, you know, what did
you're
you do to get
deal.
That? But then when you finally have something to sell, like, hey, I finally made my movie, the DVD's for sale, you bought all those people. They're not actually your fans. It's like if this
they
was-
They don't
a,
know. They are not
like
looking
if this
at your
was
feed.
A crowd of mannequins. And then we were like, thanks for coming. Come buy our book. Well, you can't get up if you're a mannequin. And so they don't mean anything. You know, 100,000 views that you bought, it doesn't mean that's 100,000 more people who saw your stuff and think you're awesome.
We learned about this in kind of an interesting way, and I won't say the name, but we managed social media for someone who had a manager who bought her a lot of followers.
Well, we didn't know that.
And we didn't know that. So we thought we were going into this account that had this amazing fan base
to help promote this new thing that was out to buy.
Yes.
And I was like, oh my God, you have all these followers. This is going to be a no-brainer. I am going to ace this. We're going to be millionaires in like 5 minutes. And then I got in, and there was like no traction, no interaction. I was like, well, that's kind of weird.
So then we started looking at the followers, and they were all like teenagers from Indonesia with locked accounts.
With locked accounts. So like, they didn't speak the they didn't speak the language of the person whose stuff they were following, and also like they were bought. They were bought. I'm not saying language barriers can't be overcome. All I'm saying is those
people didn't.
They were never going
to
buy any of her
person.
Stuff.
Yes.
So it was a total waste of time.
Yeah.
It was a waste of my time.
The bottom line there is don't buy followers. You want, and again, that's the last point here. It takes time. You want people to follow you who actually care about what you're saying and what you're doing.
Yeah.
That's the bottom line.
And we have like 6,000.
Mm-hmm. Probably all don't care.
Most people have way more than we do. I am so proud of that 6,000 because all of those people like found us and chose us. And then, you know, I'll say something rude tomorrow and they'll unfollow. Whatever, that's fine. But it's their choice. I want them to be there because they like it, not because like we
not
made
because we,
them.
Yes.
Yeah.
All right, so the other way to find people that you might be interested in or find community, basically, online is through hashtags. Hashtags are incredibly powerful, particularly on Twitter and Instagram. Other platforms have them, like Facebook has them now. They're not really useful in a community building way, whereas on Instagram and Twitter, they are incredibly powerful. And so there's three kinds of things you want to think about. One, Twitter chats. So different communities on Twitter run chats, usually weekly. It'll be like script chat, which the woman, Jeannie Bowerman, who introduced us to Brad Riddell.
She runs that.
She runs script chat. And so every Sunday night, there's all these screenwriters get online. Sometimes there's a guest screenwriter. And so sometimes they'll land like some celebrity type mm-hmm. screenwriter. And then anyone who's an aspiring screenwriter can get in on this chat and ask questions and listen and get advice. And they're like really, really fast and really, really fun. And it's just a way to meet other people, get information, and be part of a community.
Right. And usually, like with script chat specifically, they'll have a transcript of it you can go back and look at later. So mm-hmm. it's this like real resource that you can go back to if you're not available in that specific time, mm-hmm. or if someone said something that you missed. So they're really helpful. I was suspicious of Twitter chats in the beginning. I just felt like it sounded crazy.
Well, and some of them are lame, but you
go
check
the
them out
and
you find the ones you like. Yeah. Then also subject matter wise, both on Twitter and Instagram, anything you're interested in, other people are probably interested in it too. For instance, and I'm a little embarrassed to say it, I love ramen.
She really does.
I really do. And I don't just love to eat it. I like to take pictures of it and I like to look at other people's pictures of ramen. I don't know what's wrong with me. It's just something that's been happening of late.
And you know when you know someone for 15 years and then they suddenly get an Instagram account and then you find out that they love ramen a lot? That's weird.
It's weird.
That just happened.
So, but it's a way, it's a way of finding other people who are interested in what you're interested in or finding other fans of those things.
Yeah, and this is really good. So, you know, say you're making a documentary. We made a documentary about Friendly Fire. And so, which sounds very, it's very serious. We as people are not very serious, but we made a serious documentary. If you wanted to connect with other people to let them know about your documentary, you could look up the topic of your documentary through a hashtag to see other people talking about it. And you haven't met them yet, and they don't know about you yet. But then you can get in on conversations and meet them that way.
Yes. And then finally, any kind of events that you care about, they're always, now, I mean, that's just a thing. I mean, TV shows now have hashtags, so people live tweet television shows. You know, there was just, the Sundance just happened. If you're tweeting right now, feel free to tweet KFink Charm School. That's the one we use when we give these kinds of talks about social media. The Super Bowl Sunday will have a special hashtag, probably many. And
in case you can't find anyone talking about the Super Bowl, you can go and look up my hashtag because no one talks about it.
Right.
It's a quiet little thing.
Yeah. But I mean, we don't care about football at all, but we usually go watch the Super Bowl at a friend's house. And then really what we want to do is tweet stupid things with the Super Bowl hashtag.
You're on your own with that one. Yeah. I'm not doing
that. All right. So that's another way to meet people and to find people with similar interests. All right. So now
we convinced you to get on social media. We win.
You're convinced. You're doing this. You've picked your platforms. So you're on. That's great. But who the hell are you? That's the big question.
That's so rude. I asked her not to put that on there, but she was like, no, they're going to love it. I didn't mean anything.
All right, so one of the things that I'm going to actually refer to a little Aristotle now. When you're online, because, you know, you're some kind of artist already, and so you have a voice as an artist, and that, you know, that voice may change depending on what type of work you're putting out in the world, but it's something you need to think about when you're in the social media sphere, absolutely. Like, who are you? How do you want people to perceive you? How do you want people to think about you? How do you want people to react to you? And so there's basically four things you need to think about. Number one, this idea, you're the speaker. Who are you? Are you someone who's very serious? Are you someone who's very snarky? Are you grumpy? Are you fun? Like, whatever kind of part of your personality, because we all have multiple parts of our personalities. And so you want to think very carefully about which version of yourself are you putting out online? And is that an appealing version of you, perhaps? And so we're going to talk about some bad choices in this area in just a little bit, and some very good choices in just a little bit. But it's something you want to think about. So who are you going to be? Now, you can't just think about that alone, because there are some other things to consider. And those are also like your subject matter or your overall goal. So, you know, and this can change too from project to project. And so that's something Julie and I have had a very interesting time navigating, because we like to be silly and playful. But that not all of our work is silly or playful. And so sometimes our subject matter is serious. So like for instance, when we did the Friendly Fire documentary, we couldn't be tweeting about that in a jokey voice, because that is totally disrespectful and terrible, and we would never do that. So you do have to sometimes think about, like, okay, I like to be playful, but I'm working on this documentary, so I'm going to change my tone to match my subject matter, because I don't want to alienate people or confuse them when I'm making all these jokes and then putting out this very serious subject matter. The other thing to think about is your audience. Who is listening? So again, we've had to navigate this. So when we tweet as Kings of Fink, for example, we really don't care about a lot of things. We really are just ourselves. Like, we're jokey, playful,
we care about some things.
Right.
But yeah.
I mean, we're never mean.
No.
Our audience has sort of become people who just simply enjoy the way we interact and play. But when we tweet for Tello, where the audience is not other creative people, but rather true fans of the series that are put out on Tello, we have a very different tone. It's still light, but it is geared towards a lesbian audience who wants to talk about, you know, actresses and who's pretty and things like that. And so we have to change how we are communicating based on who's listening and who's playing and who's interacting.
Sure. And the purpose. I mean, right. When we're on our King is a Fink Twitter account, really we're mostly just looking to have fun. Mm-hmm. And so we will talk about anything, we'll play with anyone. It's just for fun. When we're working with Tello, you know, part of it is to have fun. Part of it is to sell subscriptions to Tello. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, mixed in with fun stuff about the actresses and fun pictures and, hey, there's a new episode. There's also, hey, don't forget, if you want to see this stuff, here's the link where you can subscribe and give us some of your money and we'll give you some fun stuff. Those are the things that are actually kind of hard to do at first. If you've just been making fun stuff, then trying to sell that fun stuff, it feels a little embarrassing. But that's going to be how you make money at doing what you're doing. So you really have to know that that's one of your goals, if that's one of your goals.
Yeah. And then the last thing, context, and in this framework, context is just which platform are you on? So, you know, Twitter does tend to lend itself more to like playful, quippy type stuff. If you're doing stuff on a blog, you have more room to play with, I think, your persona. So whatever medium or platform you're using might also influence how you can present yourself to other people or how you can craft your persona. I have a couple of examples to show you. So one, I don't know if you guys are going to be able to see this, but there are some pictures of soup on the screen. And basically one tweet is from Thug Kitchen and the other is from Vegetarian Times. Both Thug Kitchen and Vegetarian Times care about vegetarian cuisine, but they have very, very different tones because they have very, very different audiences. So Thug Kitchen tweets out stuff like, it's soup season, bitches. And
sorry for the language.
And you know, and then they have a couple of F-bombs on their picture. And so obviously that's not for your mom.
Or if your mom's cool.
Unless your mom is really cool.
It's a party now.
Whereas Vegetarian Times is more,
it's like friendly, accessible, health conscious, positive. So I forget what it says. I can't see anything. But I think it says, it has the phrase super scrumptious, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's like cutesy and like, yeah, we're going to eat something good. So it's a different tone. I mean, one is calling their audience bitches. Mm-hmm. You have to kind of have some balls to do that, actually, to have that kind of rapport. We're not going to do that with you guys. We just met you.
Right.
By the end of it, we'll be like all that. But I mean, look, like for real, these two things have the exact same aim. They're trying to get you to try their roasted soup recipe. The soups are the same color. They're both in bowls. There's bread involved. There's cute things on top of it to make it look
garnish.
Beautiful. And like, why don't I make things like this in my house? It makes me feel bad about myself. And they're accomplishing their goal in these things. And they both ultimately probably want you to buy stuff. But if you look, Vegetarian Times, actually, on theirs, there's not only the picture, but there's the link to their website, I'm assuming. So they are going to pull you over as soon as possible to get you to their site. I'm guessing to help you look at their sponsors' ads, because they have an obligation to their sponsors to do that. Mm-hmm. And then probably to sell you cookbooks or magazines or whatever they do.
Yep, absolutely.
The kitchen's a little, like, they only have a link to the picture. They don't have a link to their site. You don't need a link to the site, actually, because if you like Thug Kitchen, then you might click on Thug Kitchen and try to find their website and go find more. Mm-hmm. So they're a little less pushy about the sales part. But, I mean, for real, these things are pretty much identical, but how you spin your voice and your persona makes a huge difference.
Absolutely. And then I pulled an example from Instagram to give a sense of, too, like, just this whole idea of style. And so the top three pictures are all by this New York documentary photographer, Ruddy Roy. And he just goes out and spends all day shooting pictures of people he meets on the street. And you can tell, I mean, all of his work has this kind of smudgy, slightly vignetted kind of quality, and he does color photos too. But like his aesthetic is incredibly strong, and so whenever I'm looking through Instagram, like I always know, like Ronnie Roy is posting again, and I always look because he posts these incredibly long narratives, like almost blog posts under each picture, where he talks about his subjects, which is really, I mean, he just really honors the people that he's photographing, and he honors their stories. And so, and he's like this kind of up and coming, he's getting a lot of attention. There are tons of photographers now who use Instagram and are being, you know, plucked up by the New York Times and sent to South America to do photojournalism. So these are viable platforms to get discovered, especially I think if you have like a really strong aesthetic or a really strong voice or a really strong vision. And then the bottom one is, this girl is not gonna get picked up by the New York Times, but she has lots and lots and lots of Instagram followers. It's this girl, Naomi326. She lives in Japan. Every single day, she takes a picture of the Tokyo TV Tower at a different time of day.
And they're beautiful. You wait for them.
You do.
You're like, when's it gonna be today?
Exactly. And she does do some other photos every now and then, but this is the main thing that she does. And people love it. And again, so like this idea, like you can create a voice just simply by having a strong, like centered subject. And so that's what she's done. So again, I recommend whatever platforms you pick, go explore, find people who are doing stuff that you find interesting and see how you can tweak that and do a version of that for yourself, or how that can inspire how you do your work to, you know, cater your work to these mediums. So those are some examples of that. And now we're gonna get into who not to be on Twitter.
We're not naming names. Don't get excited.
So we're gonna talk about three social media personas not to adopt, or three ways to annoy and alienate
potential fans and collaborators.
Yes. All right. And these are all real. Like, these are all based on
real people we have encountered on Twitter, mostly.
Yeah.
So the first person not to be is the brat. This is a person who is not where they want to be in life or in their career, perhaps. They're not very happy. And so all they do is tweet out negative stuff. There are some things you need to know about the brat. The brat thinks that everything they do is amazing, and that everything you do is horrible. And if anything good happens to you, they're going to be really mad, and they will tell everyone. So we see this a lot during Sundance, because we follow a lot of filmmakers. And you know, everyone's very pro Sundance until the choices come out. And then it's a crock of you know what. Like, if you don't get accepted, then everyone's like, this is stupid. Who did they know to get in there? This is so fake. I want proof that they looked at my stuff. Well, a week ago, you were like, I'm so gonna get in. I'm so excited. So,
and Sundance is a dream come true.
Right.
Right.
It's gonna be great. I already got my ticket. I didn't get in. That guy exists.
Yes.
That girl exists.
Yes. So don't be this person.
Right. And then they'll also complain about smaller things. Like, you get excited when you post a new short or a new video on YouTube, and like, and you start checking it, right? You're like, ooh, how many people looked at it? And then you're like, 10 people? I put that on my Facebook page. I have more than 10 friends. And you start to get like mad. You might actually feel like that and disappointed or whatever. You don't maybe put it out there like a big sore loser.
You have to censor some of your feelings,
right?
On social media.
Have your feelings with your friends.
Yes.
And then present something else maybe on Twitter. You can vent a little.
Right.
I mean, we are realistic, but we're not going to like, you know, slam Sundance because we haven't been in Sundance.
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. So avoid being bratty. The next one to avoid is the monologist. These people are bores.
I'm giving the monologist credit. Number one, if they're on Twitter, they realize that Twitter is a good tool. So like they're halfway there.
The bad part is that they don't know how to entice anyone to look at anything. So for real, we see people sometimes like, I made a short, here's where to see it. I made a short, here's where to see it. Hey, look at my trailer. Hey, look at my YouTube video. Hey, look at this. And it's just like pretty much the same thing constantly and many times. And you can see when they're drinking, because then they do it a little more frequently. And it gets a little mean, like slightly mean. But like, all they do is promote their own stuff and not even creatively. Like, you know, even if you're a visual artist and you're using Twitter, this is still your way to show people that you're creative and interesting. And so if you're writing boring tweets, why do I want to look at your movie? Like, you know, it's like show why people would want to look at your stuff. And I don't mean just, hey, my stuff's real good. Look at my trailer. Like, show them what your personality is and play with them. Yeah. So,
you do. You have to find ways to entice people, and repeating yourself on an endless loop is not enticing. It's annoying.
We're going to talk about crowdfunding at the end, but this, you see this happen a lot when someone's running a crowdfunding campaign.
Yeah.
Who's on Twitter, real quick? Everybody.
Oh, good. That's good.
Most people. Who has seen people running crowdfunding campaigns on Twitter? So you guys have seen this. The crowdfunding's going, I'm really excited, here's my goal, 2 days in, and then it gets to be like 29 days in of a 30-day campaign and they're not at their goal, and you start seeing this. Oh my God, I'm not at my goal yet. Oh my God, please spread the word, blah, 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 please RT. That it just starts to happen, they start to panic and they become this guy, and it's not their fault, it's very stressful. But that's one instance where you can see this happen.
Yes. All right, and then the last one, don't be a bully. It's not nice. So we have our bully yelling at Brad Riddell over there.
Who would do that? He's so nice.
Are you too fancy to look at my video? And so we do. We see a lot of people try to like shame people into doing things. Again, especially during crowdfunding campaigns, they'll call people out by name and say, hey, why haven't you contributed to my campaign? And that, like, that it works sometimes. We have seen total bullies run crowdfunding campaigns and total bullies, you know, cajole people into doing things on Twitter. But it's tacky and it's tasteless.
Yeah.
And
it's not a way to get what you want. Like, if if we made you guys do something because we, like, shamed you into it, you know, I might get what I want in that moment. Like, okay, they clicked on my link, but are you a fan of mine? Like, are you going to care about anything else I do? No. In fact, you're going to go and say, like, Julie's a big jerk. Don't look at her stuff. So it just, I think it's a misuse of energy. Like, instead of directing super negative energy at someone, like, instead put out generally positive energy. And I don't mean, like, crystals and angels. I mean, which are fine. But I mean, like, do something nice. Give people this gift of your trailer, and you'll get better results than being like, look at my thing, you big jerk.
Yes, which actually, and that's leading us into, who do you want to be on social media? So who should you strive to be, or how? We're going to tell you three ways to charm and seduce potential fans and collaborators. And I do want to point out, yes, we have some fan dancers on the slide, and we think a lot about social media being akin to burlesque dancing. And I don't know if any of you have been to a burlesque show. If you haven't, I don't know what is wrong with you. You should go immediately, because burlesque is super fun. And so the whole point of burlesque is to sort of stretch out a tease and to give people moments of joy and delight. And this is how we approach social media, and this is how we recommend that other people approach social media. It doesn't have to be related to sex, but
but it can be.
It can be.
If you want. Also, really quick, sometimes people confuse burlesque and stripping.
They're different.
They're not the same thing. They both end up with not a lot of clothes on.
True.
But like, there are two different ways to get there. And one is like, I took them off, everything off, and then here I am. And the other one's like, it's going to take me the whole 4 minutes of my song to take it off, and there are pasties at the end, and I'm not going to give you the whole thing. You want to be the second one. I didn't do that quite right. You want to do, though, the long extended tease, one that sometimes involves feathers.
Yes. All right. So we recommend being optimistic on social media, because positivity works. being hopeful works. It's infectious. It's a way of paying compliments to people. So for example, the top sample tweet there, someday I'll work with Danny Pudi. Until then, you know, these guys, and you like give a shout out to your crew or something. And so then you're doing two things at the same time. Like you're saying what your aspirations are, you're name dropping a celebrity who might look at your tweet and see that you
they
said something nice.
And
so you're being optimistic and you're being positive, or you're talking about, you know, I haven't won an Oscar yet, but, you know, I plan to. It's like, it's one of my goals. And so you're spreading a message of hope and positivity, which is a good thing.
Right. This is not the same as being a brown noser. Like, you're not writing to Danny Pudi every single day.
Don't do that.
Like, I liked your tie in that episode, sir. Like, that's not what we're talking about. Like, that, legitimate, like, nice compliments and
that
once
is
in
how,
a while.
That is how I teach high school in addition to doing all of this. And my students are all on Twitter, and they spend most of their time trying to get celebrities to tweet to them. And so they write these obnoxious, horrible, beggy, bullying tweets to try to get the attention.
Who are they trying to get to write to them?
Justin Bieber. They really want Justin Bieber. Some people are obsessed with like Grey's Anatomy, and so they're trying to get like all the stars of Grey's Anatomy to tweet to them, and they get really crazy and they'll do like all caps tweets.
But so it's just like, at Patrick Dempsey, please write back to me. That's the only goal?
Yeah, that's their only goal. So you don't want to do that. You don't want to be beggy. You want to be positive. You want to be clever. And then chances are someone will respond positively to the positive energy that you put out there.
This is, by the way, I hope I'm allowed to say this, but this is how I got Mia Farrow to write to me. So
that is true.
You know, sometimes you just, it's a slam dunk. I invited her to tea. She was upset about Syria. And she accepted my offer. We did a rain check. But she's a busy woman. Okay, fine,
right.
Whatever, let's go.
Another person you can try to be, or another kind of persona to model yourself after, is the altruist. Be kind. Share other people's work. This is a really good way to get in the good graces of influencers and other potential collaborators. So if there's someone you admire on Twitter or Instagram or wherever, you know, repost, reshare, give them a compliment. Let other people know about them because they're gonna see it, especially this really works on Twitter. If you, like for example, you know, Tiffany Schlein, we had never met her in real life, but we saw her stuff. We liked what she did, so we started tweeting about her, and now she, you know, interacts with us all the time. And that's, it's a good, it's just, it's good, again, it's just positive.
It's a good way to build up some goodwill. So if you are, if you want to make movies, you want to find funding, you might do a crowdfunding campaign, you know, in a year or in 2 years. You start looking at other people's crowdfunding campaigns, and you can spread the word about them for them. And so, you know, if I do that for all of you, and I'm horrible at estimating numbers, all 8,000 of you, I have spread the word about all of your social media campaigns. When it's my turn, I'm not going to be like, hey, I supported you, why don't you support me? I'll put it out there, and I might bring it to your attention, and you'll remember, oh yeah, she was my backer, she helped me make my movie. Well, I'll at least spread the word, or I'll kick in $25. And you have this time as you're building up your own fan base to also build up goodwill. And that's really important. If you do good things for other people, they are more likely to do them for you.
Yeah, and it's also good to think about, like, especially if you're in film, and we all know it takes a really long time to make a film, and so there's all this time in like pre and post-production. And you don't always have something to promote. And so use some of your time on these mediums to promote other people's work, because then when it's your turn, you've done all this pre-work promoting other people's work, and they may return the favor.
Yeah, and remember, don't fall into one of those bad personas and say, hey, look, it's my turn.
Right.
I did all of yours and now it's my turn, because we've seen that too, which
yes.
I just can't believe people do that. But, you know, hey, I contributed all yours, where's my $25. Right. I'm not giving it to you. You're a jerk now. Just put it out there, and then it's there.
All right. And then the last one I kind of talked about a little bit already. You can be flirty. And that, again, if you haven't seen Burlesque, especially in Chicago, that is Michelle L'Amour. She is fantastic.
She is not paying us. We do not know her.
No.
Yet.
But we will. So you can flirt on social media. There's all right now, like it's all the rage for like these Instagram love stories of people meeting and falling in love over Instagram. That's not where we're taking this. You can.
That's your own private business.
That's right. But definitely like you can, you know, play with other people. Like these mediums they're so social, and you can play with, you know, how you're presenting yourself. And people we find are really open to just being flirted with and flirting back.
Yeah, it's fun. It's fun in real life. It's fun on social media. And some of the movies that we made about 5 years ago, we made a series of movies called Our Kinky Cuties. And so we were involved in a kinky film festival. And then so we would play a lot when we were promoting those movies when they were on the film festival. And then so things maybe got a little more on the flirty, sexy end than they were when we were promoting our documentary. So definitely. It also depends on, you know, where you are in your promotion phase of your thing. Mm-hmm. But it's fun. It's fun. You get a little boost. You give a little boost. If you meet someone, good for you.
Absolutely. All right. So those are some, that kind of brings us to, that was a lot of information.
Yes, I need a nap.
Does anyone need a nap, a little snooze? All right, we don't either. So we're gonna move now to start talking about crowdfunding. So the key, one thing to think about, everything we've just said is like the precursor and the lead in to being able to run a crowdfunding campaign. Like if you've just been waiting for this moment, you ignore everything we've said, that's a disaster. All right, so you want people to give you money to fund your art.
Yes, I do.
But you're still going to have to earn it because it's not free. I think we've seen a lot of people with crowdfunding, they think, oh my God, it's free money. Mm-hmm. And I just have to put my project down there and then the money is just going to come. You even saw that with a high-profile campaign, Spike Lee's campaign that he ran last year. In his pitch video, he said, well, I saw that Zach Braff did it, so now
no,
it's my
turn.
No,
didn't he say one of my assistants saw that Zach Braff did it?
Yes.
Which, whatever, that's awesome. Good for him. But yeah, it was kind of like, so I'm going to try it now too. And he got a lot of criticism, yeah. And then that was a great campaign to watch. If you're going to do crowdfunding, take a look at that one. And look at all the responses to it and then his response back. Because eventually he came back and he did, you can do updates on your crowdfunding campaigns. And he wanted to clarify, like, look, I didn't mean this is free money and this is definitely a lot of work. And I respect all the other smaller independent filmmakers who are doing this. I'm not taking it for granted. And that was a great move on his part.
Yeah.
There are good ways to do it and bad ways to do it.
All right. So we're going to go over just some really of the basic things. Because again, if you don't already have a solid social media presence, you can't run a crowdfunding campaign. A few things about crowdfunding.
It's a horrible, awful, stressful thing that no one should ever do. This is true.
This is really true. Like you have to know going into this, whatever you're going to pick, like a 30-day campaign, it's going to be the 30 most stressful days of your life. It also can be really fun.
Yeah.
Like the one that we did for ourselves, super stressful, but also we had a blast doing it. But it's also, obviously, it's very freeing because it's a way to fund your art without having to go woo investors, which is a very different skill set that we do not have.
Like
we could never be doing a panel on how to woo investors because we don't know how.
No.
And then obviously I think we just kind of came into this era. One of the early film festivals we went to, there was this guy who billed himself. Wasn't he the angry filmmaker?
It was something like that.
He was like the angry filmmaker and he went around to film festivals and he just made angry speeches. And part of the reason he was so angry is because he had made a feature film and he had gone close to $1 million in debt to make it.
And he lost, I feel bad we're talking about this. You know what, whatever. He lost his house, he lost his family, because debt does that sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Sometimes your wife isn't going to stay with you when you have $900,000 right. in debt for a shitty first film.
We don't know about the quality of his movie. It might have been really good. But there was this era, though. Like, I feel like in the 80s and 90s, there wasn't crowdfunding. There wasn't social media the way there is now. And if you wanted to make a movie, you had to pay. Like, your first movie, you just have to pay for it. I mean, we know people now who have taken out loans or used their student loans to make movies. And then they've made their movie, and then it's like, oh my gosh, I have all these bills. That sucks, right? That's like getting the check after you eat the awesome meal. And so this gives you an opportunity to say, like, here's my budget. I'm going to keep it small because I'm very smart and very practical and very economical. I have all these friends in Chicago. They're going to do some favors for me. I'm going to have a reasonable budget. I'm going to pay it before all this even happens. And now I have a movie and no debt.
Yes.
That's what you want. Don't go into debt making your first movie, because the thing is, your first movie is probably not going to be very good. Yeah. Yours are going to be good. Most people's first movies are not very good. Our first movies are not very good.
No, they're terrible. We would never show them to you.
And that would be horrible for us to be paying bills on those horrible, horrible shorts that we had. So
yeah, you learn as you go.
Crowdfunding gives you a chance to do these things and not be in debt.
Yes. Okay. All right. So before you crowdfund, there's a couple of things you really have to have in place. One, you have to have a community. That's what we've been talking about doing all prior to now, is building an online community. Because again, crowdfunding happens online. I mean, you can have like supplementary house parties and brick and mortar things to go along with crowdfunding, but primarily crowdfunding is an online phenomenon.
Right. Having a community does not mean having a Facebook account of only your friends and family.
Right.
That does not count as a community that you can count on for crowdfunding. Mm-hmm. And here's why. If you don't have a social media community and you run a crowdfunding campaign and all you have is your friends and family, you're a jerk. Because you just put all the pressure of funding your first movie on your friends and family. And that's not a nice thing to do. Like, your parents just like raised you and put you through this amazing college. And then now they also have to give you $1,000 so you can make your short. So you want to get that pressure off of your friends and family and make it so that Thanksgiving's not super awkward by opening it up to other people who might actually want to see your stuff.
Absolutely. So you want to have a community. As we've been saying all this whole time, you need to be on social media. You have to know, you have to have a long-term vision for your project. So it's not something that you can do on the spur of the moment and, you know, it's not something you're going to do really fast. You should, especially now, I think maybe 3 years ago or so when Kickstarter and Indiegogo were just starting, I think a lot of people could kind of get away with just getting on and being like, yeah, we're going to shoot a movie. I don't really know that much about it, but it's going to be great. Now people expect a lot more, and they want to see that you have, you know, that you have a script, that you have a marketing plan, that you might have been thinking about distribution, or whatever. Mm-hmm. And this goes for, we have kind of fell into just talking about film. This goes for whatever kind of thing you're crowdfunding. Mm-hmm. They want to see that you have a plan and that you have a vision. This is a really big one. Julie yells at people about this all the time, who she consults for, that you have to, if you want people to give you money online through Kickstarter, go support other people's Kickstarter campaigns.
You could do it for a dollar.
Yeah.
If you have $10, you can support 10 projects. And then you look like this big
spender.
Like, hey, they've done 10 projects. But you can't say, hey, this is awesome. I'm going to use Kickstarter. Help me out. Because on that page, this is your Kickstarter page. Here's your pitch video. Is this working? No. On your page, there's a thing that says how many Kickstarter projects of other people's you've supported.
Right.
And Indiegogo has the same thing. Mm-hmm. And if it says, like, Julie Keck is going for $50,000 and she supported no one ever, that's so not fair. Like, you have to give to get. So,
yes.
And plus, you also want to look at other people's crowdfunding campaigns when you're supporting them to see which ones are good, to go through the process, so that you know how to answer questions, and so that you're supporting other people.
Yeah, so again, I think we say social media, social media, social media. People forget that it is social, and they forget that it is about community. And so do the things that like a good neighbor does or a good community member does, and you know, actually contribute if you want people to contribute to you. And then if possible, it's good. It's probably not the best idea to crowdfund your very first thing if you have nothing to show. That, again, I think that worked like 3 years ago, and now it's a lot harder. And even when we did our first crowdfunding campaign, between us and the director, Phil, we had made numerous shorts, many of which had been on the film festival circuit. He had made shorts that had been on the film festival circuit. So we at least, none of us had made a feature. So it was our first feature. That was really exciting. But we all had work to show, like, this is what, you know, this is our sensibility. This is our technical know-how, so that people could get a sense that actually something decent might come out of funding us.
Yeah, but I mean, I would assume if you got, I'm just going to pretend that all of you are film students at this school right now, like, you know each other. You're all learning how to use these skills together right now. You have access to equipment and awesome advisors. Like, go make some stuff for each other for free. Like, yeah. Go DP on someone else's thing, and then they'll do it on yours, and you can make some things for free, and then you practice, and then you all have things to show other people.
Yep.
And that's okay. They don't have to be, you know, Hollywood blockbuster level shorts. Just show people what your aesthetic is and your style and your vision, and then you have something to show people. If you don't have anything, you're like, hey, I'm going to be an amazing director. Give me $200. It's like, I don't know.
All right, so those are things to think about before you crowdfund. When you're ready to crowdfund, then you have to think of a couple of more things. You have to have a reasonable goal.
$100 million.
Yeah, $100 million. It's a tough business. Everyone thinks they need $1 million. You don't need $1 million.
No.
And especially on your first thing, you don't need $1 million.
No.
And also, it doesn't matter. Even if you need $1 million, you just might not be able to have $1 million. Like, if you don't have the social media clout or the reach, you're not going to get $1 million. So you need to think of, okay, you know, I have X number of people who like my Facebook fan page, and I have X number of people on Twitter, and I have X number of people on Instagram.
And the statistics show that about this many people in your community give, mm-hmm. and the average contribution is $25, so maybe I can make about this. Can I make a movie for $23,000? Maybe, hopefully.
Yeah. Right.
If not, then you have to keep growing your community.
Yeah, so you have to, we see people all the time overshoot, and that's sad. You have to think about the timing of your campaign. Mm-hmm. So do you want to talk about that?
Yeah. I mean, if you want to shoot in a month, then you shouldn't start it today. And you can run campaigns for longer. Statistics show that running it for 30 days is the best amount. You're not wearing everyone out. Because it is tiring not only to run the campaign, but to see it every day for mm-hmm. your fans. And so you want to keep it shorter. And then you also want to give yourself time to still plan afterwards, because if you're in pre-production during the time that you're doing your crowdfunding campaign, you're going to be super stressed.
Yeah.
You're still going to be in pre-production, but then give yourself time, first of all, to get the money. It usually takes about 2 weeks to get the money that you got if you use Kickstarter. If you use Indiegogo and you do a flexible campaign, we don't need to go into this level of detail, but whatever, you get the money as you go. And so you want to make sure that you can have the money and then have time to set up the things you're going to use the money for.
Mm-hmm. Okay. You want to think about who's your team, because your team can help you. They have networks too, hopefully. So, and actually, we've been more and more strategic, especially with our Tello projects, around who we want to be in our shows. Like, we want actors who use social media, especially if we think we might crowdfund for something. So that's something, and that's kind of new, and that not all actors want to do that, but we tell them they have to.
Right. Well, that's something that we have to do, being a digital and social media based company.
Yes.
That's how we find our subscribers, and so that brings people to our stuff.
But it's worth thinking about. Like, if you think you're going to run a crowdfunding campaign, and you know, you're thinking between two DPs, and one DP has like also is a photographer and has an amazing Instagram following, pick that guy, because he has people who care about his work, and he's going to get some of those people and convert them into people who are going to care about your work and give you money. You have to think about your perks.
So if you have a crowdfunding campaign, you're asking people for money, and then there's also this thing called perks, and you give people something for their pledge.
Don't do t-shirts.
Don't do t-shirts. Don't do anything you have to send people. It just is a pain in the you know what later. But you have to think about the things that you're going to give the people who contributed to your money, your crowdfunding campaign. And so, yeah, stay away from physical perks. Make the perks specific to your project. So,
like for instance, with Telo's run a couple of crowdfunding campaigns recently for some higher budget shows, and they'll do like signed scripts, mm-hmm. something like that,
and signed headshots,
and signed headshots, and anything that's really easy like that. That's and the thing is fans want them. Like if a fan, you know, likes the show and likes the actors in the show, they want those. They want those things, and it's like the easiest thing in the world to give them. And so,
but like when we crowdfunded for the feature thriller that we did, like we're nobodies. Mm-hmm. Everyone involved with the movie was nobodies, which is fine. That's what you do in the beginning, mm-hmm. or maybe always. And so we didn't have, you know, I'm not going to sign a headshot and send it to you. That would be the lamest thing you've ever gotten in the mail. So what we did instead was we had certain perks, like if you pledge $15, we'll make a fun bio for you in this fake town we made on Google Maps. Mm-hmm. And we called it Tilt the Town. And everyone who contributed $15 or more got a bio that was kind of, like if we kind of knew them, we kind of made it based on them. But if we didn't know them, we just made stuff up. Mm-hmm. And we included a link to their real Twitter account. And we included a link to their real website. And that way it became a real networking opportunity. Mm-hmm. Plus, since we were the writers of the movie, it gave us a chance to show before anyone saw this movie that wasn't going to be available for several years, it gave them a chance to see that we actually can write and we can come up with fun characters and we can play with people. And so, you know, for $15, we wrote a paragraph. And then we connected everyone. So this guy is married to this lady, and this guy works for this guy. So we ended up having to write 250 of these. That was a lot, but it was totally worth it. It was super fun. It was if there was any money attached to that, I would do that full time because it was so fun. If we had made it into a Sims game, it would have been super fun. But that's the thing. Like, we didn't have to send anything out to anyone. It wasn't a t-shirt. It wasn't a DVD. We made this thing. It existed on the web. It showed something about us. It was an awesome perk.
Yeah, it was. So there's, when you think about perks, a lot of times people do go right to the physical. There are many non-physical things that you can do. And we do think it's a good idea if you can think of something creative that shows off, like, your talent, especially if you're a newcomer, that's the best way to go. Okay, and then you obviously have to, you know, for any kind of Kickstarter or Indiegogo campaign, you have to have a pitch video, and more and more, they have to be really good. Like, this is no longer the time when you can do this on your webcam in your dark, dark bedroom with, you know, your dog in the background gnawing on, you know, your shoe.
It's true. Well, and if you're a filmmaker, your pitch video should show like at least a little bit of what you can do. So again, it doesn't have to be Michael Bay explosions, but it should like have good sound, have good lighting, you know, good transitions. It should look good. And it can be just a super short little video, but this is your one chance to tell people why they should invest in your stuff. So make it good.
Absolutely. Okay, so the two platforms, and we've mentioned them a number of times already, Kickstarter and Indiegogo are the two big ones. There are tons more. I mean, in this technology world that we're living in, there's tons of copycat everything now. And I'm sure the other platforms are lovely.
Yeah.
We've looked at some of them. They're nice. Yes. But the thing is, I think with Kickstarter and Indiegogo, they're the most known. And so you have the best chance of kind of roping in new people who might just be kind of browsing on these sites to look for cool stuff. Whereas some of the lesser known crowdfunding platforms, there's just not the traffic.
Right. These will inspire a little trust. So especially if you're new, they might not know you, but they do know Kickstarter. And so it's like, okay, I know that's a legit site and a thing, so use that. Some of them, like Seed and Spark, they actually help promote the projects more. Kickstarter and Indiegogo don't do it quite as much, partly because of the volume of projects on their thing. So,
And then if people have questions about these ones, they can ask that during the Q&A. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right. Okay, so that's the two platforms you should probably consider. All right, then after the campaign.
Wait, blah, blah, blah. You did your campaign. It was wildly successful. Nice job. Okay, now.
So we get, you've done it. Yes, you've made your goal. You need to thank your backers. That's another thing. I think a lot of people, they just, if they have that kind of initial Spike Lee attitude of like, ooh, there's money out here, I'm just going to get it. They're forgetting this fundamentally important thing, which is that crowdfunding is not actually about money. It is about community. It is about building a group of like cohesive backers who are fans and who want to support you. They've invested in you. They've given you their money, and now they want to see you succeed. And so you have to keep in touch with them. You have to keep interacting with them. You have to thank them. You have to, you know, be kind to them. You have to just, you know, be grateful for what they've given you and treat them as a community. And so Julie mentioned that we did Tilt the Town when we did our Tilt Kickstarter. And that was one way we built a tremendously strong community doing that. And we were, people still like talk about Tilt the Town.
They talk about the characters that we made for them.
Yeah.
And they interact with each other.
Yes. And so that's a really important thing to remember. These are people, they've invested in you. Be kind and thank them. And keep them apprised. So many people, they get their money and then they drop off the face of the earth. Mm-hmm. And you never hear from them again.
It's really rude.
It's really rude. Like, again, the goal of this is you are creating, you know, you might find, you know, we had like 200 and...
Like 13 or something.
Yeah. Or, you know, you might find, if you find 200 people who are rooting for you, you want to keep those people. Keep them rooting for you forever. And so you want to tell them what you're doing, let them know, like, if there's a perk delay or if there's mm-hmm. a delay in the what you projected as your workflow. You want to just keep them in the loop because, again, they helped you out.
And yeah. So. And they're, you know, even if they just gave you $1 or $25, one of the things that's really hard for beginning filmmakers is to create an email list. It's something that everyone tells you should do, and you should do that. When you crowdfund, we're horrible at it, but you get a chance to have all these people's emails. And so then either through, you know, the crowdfunding platform or through your own email list, you still can communicate with people. You can communicate with them about your future projects. And so maybe we crowdfunded 3 years ago and we made that movie and it came out. That's not the end of your relationship with your backers in this community. You're like, hey, thanks for supporting that thing. Hey, I'm making a new movie. Mm-hmm. You know, do you want to contribute to this crowdfunding campaign if you feel like you want to go back and do that? Or would you mind spreading the word about it? Or hey, I just think you would like it. I mean, hopefully you're not only going to make one thing and have that be the end. Like, this is a long-term thing. This is a career. And so whatever you get, you want to keep it and build on it.
Yeah. So that is the thing. You want to remember that you want to, as much as possible, you want to keep this community and you want to build on it over the course of your career. Okay. That was long.
All right.
That was very long. It's all a blur now.
So we're open for questions. Mm-hmm. If anyone has anything about social media or crowdfunding or anything that we suggested.
Oh, and there's a microphone for you to...
Oh, hello.
Wow, this is super fancy.
If you guys could line up behind the mic if you have questions.
Then... Feel free to stretch.
Did you guys know there was a microphone over there? I didn't know it was going to be like that. We can't hear you.
Okay.
Ooh. Now we can.
Now we can.
Yeah, hi.
Thanks for coming. My question is... I think an attitude that some filmmakers have is they don't want to put their short film on YouTube, maybe because they want to put it in festivals or they think someone's going to buy this, and if they put it on YouTube, they can't do that. I'm just interested to hear your comments on that.
No one's going to buy your short. That's the short answer.
Yeah. I mean, when have you ever bought a short? Have you guys bought a short?
Yeah.
Shorts are awesome.
Shorts are great. You know what? A short is actually a calling card. So you absolutely should put it online where people can see it and see what you can do. And I think there is some validity to saying, well, first I want to see if I can run it on the film festival circuit. Mm-hmm. Sure. If you want to save it first and, you know, enter as many film festivals as you can, get a good run going. No one really is going to buy it. And if they do, they're going to give you like $200. And I think the difference between having $200 versus having a place to send like a potential producer or collaborator to look at your work, the $200 isn't worth it.
I think we felt like that a little bit in the beginning. You know, you made this thing, it's your baby, you don't want to give it away. But then you start to make more stuff and then you realize it's okay because more is coming and it feels a little more comfortable. Does that help?
Yeah, I was just curious. Yeah.
Sure. Thank you.
Hi.
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 How long do you think the period should be when you're telling people you have a crowdfunding campaign coming up, but it hasn't started yet, mm-hmm. like advertising for it beforehand?
That's a great question. Mm-hmm. I am not a fan of teasing anything. Like, I know we just told you for an hour and a half tease everything. That was all.
But we mean flirty-teasy all the time.
But you don't want to be the guy who for a month is like, got something big coming. I got a big announcement for you coming up, not telling you what. I think it's good if you're tweeting that you're going to make a movie. It's good if you're tweeting and putting out there that you're ramping up production or that you're getting actors and finding a crew. I wouldn't really, I don't know, you might disagree. I wouldn't be like, hey, in 2 weeks we're starting a crowdfunding campaign. Because for me, I might be like, I might unfollow you for now so I don't have to see all of that and then come back, catch you on the other side. So I wouldn't. I would announce it on the day of or just maybe a couple days before. But yeah. You're gonna, for the 30 days or whatever of your campaign, it's gonna take over your life and it's gonna take over your Twitter feed or whatever you're using to promote it. And so I would stay crowdfunding less as long as you can until you're like in that deep water.
Yeah. So. You could though, I would say this, if you are looking to kind of prep some people, do it in person. So it's always a good idea with crowdfunding to know where some of your money is going to come from in advance. And so it's not a bad idea to go and like talk to your friends or people that you know with money and say, hey, I'm going to be doing this. I would love it if you would contribute. Most of the time people will tell you then on the spot, yeah, I'll throw you $1,000 or whatever. And it is good to know that in advance. And then you kind of, as you're kind of finalizing your final goal number, like you can be like, okay, so-and-so and so-and-so and so-and-so told me, I know I have 5,000 coming in here. That's a good idea. I agree with Julie about not
putting it on social media. One thing you can do though to prepare people is if you have an email list or you know you have your list of people who you have email addresses for just personally, if you write to people before your crowdfunding campaign starts and you say, hey, I'm about to launch a crowdfunding campaign, will you help me get the word out? And then that way you're letting them know that it's coming without saying, hey, can I have some money? And that's a pretty classy way to get it in someone's mind so that then when they see it a second time, they're like, oh yeah, he talked about that. I like him. I'm gonna contribute. Yeah. So kind of doing it behind closed doors and then you'll unleash it on the world through your Twitter feed.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, okay. Do you have any suggestions or tips on how to stray away from being annoying when trying to ask for money?
Yes. How much time do you have?
Just in general.
Yeah, I would say, so when you're crowdfunding, so say you're doing it for 30 days. It's going to be a really big focus of your life. The best way to not get annoying about it is to also tweet about other things. Mm-hmm. And so it's true, it's gonna be on your mind. You're gonna be refresh, seeing if anyone's contributed, who isn't, why hasn't my mom given any money yet? I'm really mad at her. You want to tweet about other things. And so the things that you were tweeting about before you started crowdfunding, mm-hmm. you still want to keep tweeting about those things. So like, hey, this thing happened in the news. Hey, the Super Bowl is coming. Hey, you know, here's a picture of my cat. Whatever it is you were doing before, keep doing those things, because that's why your followers are following you. Okay. It's because they like you for those things.
Mm-hmm. The other thing to keep in mind, again, so much of this, like if you're an artist, like you're creative, you make things, so when you're thinking about organizing your campaign, you can come up with clever ways to do it that's not just asking. So mm-hmm. I'm going to go refer back to our crowdfunding campaign with Tilt the Town. Once people understood that we were writing these bios and that they could go look at them in Google Maps and that they were super fun, we did not have to ask for money for the rest of the campaign. Because people started playing as their personas that we created for them in Tilt the Town. And so, for instance, we had, like, you know, the mayor of Tilt the Town was in a fight about garden gnomes with the housing authority director. And those two guys...
In real life.
In real life. One of them is a screenwriter and one of them is a producer. They took on those personas and started fake fighting on Twitter, constantly referring to Tilt the Town and to our campaign, mm-hmm. and all these other people got into that. And so suddenly, people were just playing and having fun, mm-hmm. and I want my persona. I want to be in Tilt the Town.
I want to fight with somebody.
Do I get a carnival? What do I get to do? So people did that, and so we just had fun, and it became not ASCII anymore.
Okay.
So think of something fun.
Think of something way more brilliant than Tilt the Town.
Yeah.
Okay.
You can do something cooler.
All right. Challenge accepted.
Hello. In regards to social media, specifically Twitter, if you're building a brand and you have a personal Twitter account and you have a brand Twitter account, which one do you choose? What's the best way to approach that?
That's a tough one. I think it depends on what kind of brand.
Like a film production company?
Yeah, just maybe like you're doing like an internet show where it's like weekly output of information, but in the brand you represent yourself.
Mm-hmm. In the brand, within the brand.
Yeah.
I would say just keep it simple and make it one, and you could even just make it your own. Mm-hmm. Like for instance, our king is a fink. It's us and our production company, but it's also us as people, and we just have kind of combined those things. Sometimes people who are filmmakers will create a separate Twitter account for every single movie that they make.
Or every show or every whatever.
Yeah, and then they have all these little groups of people that aren't connected. And so since we just have King as a Fink, everyone who has, you know, enjoyed anything we've done in the past, whether it was a speaking thing or a movie or a web series, they all know where to find us, and they know where to find us for our old stuff, and they know where to find us for our new stuff.
Yeah. When we first started, you know, that's the question. And so when we first started, we also, you know, we have a Facebook fan page, and we would make Facebook fan page for every single movie we did.
Every short,
because we were naive. And what we learned very quickly is that is completely unmanageable. Like you can't, there's not enough to say. It splits people up. Like, oh, mm-hmm. you know, these 500 people like this project and, you know, 300 of them also like this other project, but then there's 200 other people. You don't want this massive accumulation of little buckets. You want to put them all in the same bucket.
Yeah.
So
unless you're, I don't know you yet, unless like your company is a very straight-laced thing and you're like a raunchy guy or like really out there, very political, and you don't want that connected, then I guess you would want to do two separate ones. But then you would, I would guess, at least from your personal one, want to use that to get people to go to your professional one.
Great.
So.
Great, thank you.
Yeah.
Oh.
Oh, sure.
Come on
Please.
Up,
yes. Yeah.
Okay, so when I was trying to promote this particular event, I committed a 12-fa, didn't I?
Oh.
Yeah.
No.
Let's talk about spamming.
Oh.
Yeah, I was hoping you guys would get to that.
Oh, that's right. Okay,
yeah,
sure.
Yeah, so what does it mean to spam someone?
Okay. Number one, we are totally against spam. Number two.
Well, DePaul, I was spamming DePaul.
But so it wasn't really spamming, and you didn't do it on purpose. So what Brad did was, you know, the announcement finally came out, the poster was finally out, and we had something to promote. And so he was excited to promote it, and which we really appreciated. And so then he did one of those tweets that starts with the Twitter handle and then a message after. So if you do that, you write a tweet, it starts with a someone's Twitter handle, so at King is a Fink. The only people who can see that are the people who follow you and me. They have to follow both of us to see that message. So if you want something to be public, you have to either put something before the Twitter handle, like hey or yo, because you guys are cool, or a period. Some people just do a period. And so that doing that will make the tweet public. So there's that. But then he also was like, hey, DePaul, you come to this thing. And then, hey, Kartemquin, which is an awesome documentary film company that you should know in Chicago, if you know, if you like documentaries, you know, King is a Fink is coming to DePaul. Why don't you come to it? Totally good intentions. I mean, but it's not the best use of your energy because you're only getting the word out to one person at a time. And so it's better to kind of put it out there and get their attention to you in other ways.
Like
so that
how?
They see all your messages. So,
so you guys are good at this. You turn this play, you use the word play a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And when you're talking about what you do, you talk about playing.
Yes.
And there's a way to craft this hook or
yes.
this tease
so one,
to get someone to bite. And
exactly.
then they play with you. And then everyone who follows Kartemquin is seeing this conversation.
Right. So instead of saying, at Kartemquin, come to this thing with King as a Fink, we then wrote one that was that said, hey, Kartemquin, number one, congrats on going to Sundance with the Eber Doc. Number two, congrats on just raising over $150,000 with your crowdfunding campaign. If you want to come and have drinks on Friday, we're going to be at DePaul. Here's the link. And they responded to that. Because it wasn't like, hey, I have this thing, come to this thing. Or, hey, I want you to buy this thing, come buy this thing. It is, hey, I know a little bit about you. I did my research. You know, I'm going to flatter you a little bit. Totally justified on their part. They're amazing people. But it's a way to ask someone to do something for you without asking them. You invite them to do something fun. We totally did this to you, by the way. That's why we're here.
She told me I got punked in a private message. So another question I wanted to ask is, how do you, the two of you, manage the one Twitter account for King is a Fink?
There's a schedule on the refrigerator.
No, we just take turns. I mean, we just play. And sometimes we'll be on there at the same time and we'll be playing within our own account.
With each other. It's very confusing. I wouldn't follow us.
In our living room.
It doesn't make any sense.
And also we know the King of the Fink voice.
Mm-hmm.
And so people love to play the game of like who's tweeting. And it's
I know you asked
no
that
one.
I asked that every. I mean, I think that every
tell.
Time I talk to you, so
yeah.
I don't know who it is.
So we know our voice, and we can both do it. And so, yeah.
Yeah.
It just and we don't with other Twitter accounts we manage like with Tello. We actually like we have a regimen. We know like we have to have a certain number of tweets every day, and we have to promote these shows, and we have to do all this. Kinds of stuff, mm-hmm. and we have to have tweet fests and all this stuff. With King of the Fink now, because we have so much other work, we really just, there's no scheduling, there's no, it's just like, oh, let's go play with people
yeah.
and see who's
it's like
available.
Downtime, it's fun downtime.
It's yeah, now it's more like, it's a form of, really, we use that word play a lot. We use it as a form of play.
Mm-hmm.
And how many accounts are you managing at the moment?
Too many.
A lot. I do 7 or 8 for PBS Media Shift, and I do a Tello accounts, mm-hmm. Twitter and Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
For individual series and for Tello?
No.
Just for Tello.
Just for Tello.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Some series on Tello will have their own accounts, but mm-hmm. that is only if they have fully produced it and we are only their distributor.
Okay.
So any Tello made show where Tello is obviously also the distributor, we keep our philosophy intact that we're not starting new accounts for each Tello show because we would be dividing our audiences.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah. But altogether with that, and then I have other clients. I'm probably managing 20 or 25
Basically,
accounts.
Julie rules Twitter. That's what you all...
I just talk to myself all day long.
That's right.
Hey, PSE asked me, what are you doing? I don't know, Tello, you look good today. And I giggle to myself when I'm sitting at my own office in my desk. It's fun for me. I don't know how it is for anybody else.
What about... one more thing I wanted to ask and about web series, because you guys are doing great work in web series. You're making money at it. You're generating multiple series. Talk about this medium. Talk about what you like about it. Talk about how it differs from the other stuff you've done. Talk about why people should be working in this medium and how maybe they should start approaching it. What is a web series in your mind? How do you develop it? And then I guess how you promote it, given the talk that you're doing.
No, great question.
That is a great question. So we never, ever in a million years thought we would make web series. I mean, they didn't exist when we started.
And then the first ones were just crummy. They were just, someone in their apartment making two people doing a quick thing, which is fun. That's how you get started.
Yeah.
But we hadn't seen a lot of good ones.
Mm-hmm. And then, so once we started doing it, we did it really just because we were really willing to try anything. I mean, we had had movies on the film festival circuit. It wasn't super lucrative. And one of our goals has always been, like, this is how we want to spend our time. This is how we want to spend our life. So it has to support us, because you can't... I mean, currently, I still have a job. Julie does all film and all social media all the time. And then right now, the way Tello is, this should be my last year of teaching, and then I should be fully doing Tello and making web series. And so it has proven to be really lucrative, and that was our goal. So we tried it because we thought, like, maybe this is a path that will work for us. And so the way we think about, really, web series are just little TV shows.
Mm-hmm.
The series we have done for Tello, our episodes are anywhere between like 7 and 20 minutes long. We have shows that range, like we have like 10 episode seasons.
Mm-hmm.
And we approach it, like we're writing a TV series. And for a while that had been our goal anyway. Like we wanted to when we first started and we're super naive, we were like, we're gonna get into Sundance.
Totally.
And then we're gonna get a 3-picture deal. And then we're going to have a show on HBO.
Then we're going to settle in and sail into the horizon with our HBO show.
Right.
That would be awesome.
That was a great dream. But now we have a version of that. And we do, we have pretty much total creative control over whatever we do. We have a producer, and she's fantastic. And as long as there is enough kissing, we can pretty much do whatever we want.
In this series.
Yeah. Sorry. That's just true. That's the note. There needs to be more kissing. And we're like, okay. Yeah. I guess.
No, but more also, one of the reasons why it was so great to get into this is before we'd been making all of our stuff mostly by ourselves. Mm-hmm. And then when we worked with the guy with Tilt, then he directed it and edited it, and that was awesome. But to team up with Tello, we have a producer. We have someone funding our work. Like, for the first time, we're not putting out our own money to make our stuff.
Yeah, we have paid zero money to fund any of our shows.
We can make our own ideas come to life. And that's the whole point, right? Mm-hmm. So, and then once it's on Tello, Tello distributes it, Tello has subscribers, and we get a cut of what comes in.
Mm-hmm.
And so now we have this residual income from these three different series that really gives us an incentive to make more series, because it's nice money. And we didn't even know that was possible.
Yeah, we didn't know, and we just actually not too long ago learned the term for it, passive income. We didn't know that you could set up a passive income like this, where you make a show or you make a product, and then it's out in the world, and it's been monetized, and then for as long as it's out in the world, they just money comes to you,
mm-hmm.
and it's nice. So,
but it's fun.
Yeah, and it's fun.
But we do... Working in web series is fun. I mean, our scripts are just as long as feature film scripts.
Yep.
Our characters are as deep as we want them to be.
Mm-hmm.
We can explore any genre that we want to. And we have the support network to make it actually happen. So instead of wanting to make stuff someday, we can get stuff made now.
Right.
And like something that we write right now, we can shoot by the end of the year.
Yeah.
And you know, you can write a script and then hold on to it and look for someone to help you make it for years and never make anything. And that sucks. And so this is a way to actually make things. And then sort of like the person who asked about, you know, having a short, should I let people see it or not? Like now we actually have shows that people can watch and find. And if they want to give us something bigger, that's awesome.
Yeah.
You know, we're not aspiring filmmakers, we're filmmakers.
Absolutely. So we've been told we have to wrap up.
Great. Well, so, thank you all for coming. Yeah. Thank you all for coming.
Yeah, thank you. And,